You have been listening to the Hauser High School Band under the direction of Charles Biggs, director. We'll ask them to play the national anthem at this time, and I would ask that you remain standing after the national anthem for the invocation which will be given to us by Dr. Ard Hoven, minister of the First Christian Church.
Heavenly Father, we invoke thy blessing upon the purpose of this occasion as we gather this day to dedicate this structure and its appurtenances. We are grateful for the elements of stone and brick and bronze as they are utilized in fabricating an instrument of worth and service and beauty for our community. May this library and all that it houses provide illumination, a zest for information, for all who enter. Grant that the design and the fulfillment of that design, realized first in the minds of the architects and artists, and later, as here today, experienced in structure, bring joy and satisfaction to the hearts of our people, both now and in the years to come. This is our petition in the name of the Christ, even Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Hoven. We're happy to also have on our program this afternoon the Columbus High School Choir under the direction of Gerald Robertson. They will now sing "Man Is As of Grass." Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all of you here this afternoon for the dedication ceremony for the Cleo Rogers Memorial Library. So far, the weatherman has cooperated with us beautifully. We really hope that you'll enjoy the program that we have arranged. And I also hope that each of you received this brochure, which has been distributed. It carries with it the program for the day, also a history of the library. It carries some facts and figures on the operation of the library and the library building and the large arch. We have made no attempt, you'll notice, to recognize the large number of people who have given many, many dollars to make all this possible. But really, we felt that none of you really wanted that kind of recognition, and that really what you wanted to see was people using and enjoy the great library facilities that we have here. And that will be our thanks over the years to come. And that's enough. We have a number of honored guests here this afternoon, and at this time I would like to introduce them to you. The wind's not very cooperative up here. On my immediate left is Mr. Kenneth D.B. Carruthers, formerly with I.M. Pei Partners Architects. Mr. Carruthers was the architect in charge of design and production on the Cleo Rogers Memorial Library. Mr. Carruthers. Seated next to him are Mr. and Mrs. J. Irwin Miller. Mr. and Mrs. Miller, would you please stand? On my right and seated in the back row is a representative of Dunlap & Company, the general contractor, Mr. Gerald B. Dunlap. Mr. Dunlap. We are also honored today to have in our midst two elected state officials sitting in the on my right in the back row. First is the Honorable Robert D. Garten, who is State Senator of Bartholomew and Johnson County. Mr. Garten. Seated next to him is Honorable Robert Hardin, State Representative of Bartholomew, Jackson, and Decatur Counties. Mr. Hardin. The library could not function without a group of interested citizens. And here in Columbus, we have several such groups, two of which are represented here on the platform this afternoon. I would like to introduce to you Mrs. Richard M. Bishop, who is president of the Bartholomew County Library Association. Mrs. Bishop. Seated next to Mrs. Bishop is Mr. Norman Morris, who is president of the Bartholomew County Library Foundation. Mr. Morris. We have another noted guest with us today from the state level. She has been with us on many occasions, and she helped us a number of times throughout our construction project. As you know, we did have some federal funds for the construction of the building, and these funds were administered by the state library. And we are honored today to have Ms. Marcelle K. Foote, director of the Indiana State Library, with us. Ms. Foote. These next seven people I would like to introduce to you as a group. Would you please hold your applause until I've introduced them all? These people make up the library board. In the back row on my left, Mrs. M. Eugene Brierley. Please remain standing, if you will. Mr. Frederick Meyer. Mr. J. O. Kelly. On the front row, Mr. Robert L. Stevenson, who is currently vice president and is a past president of the board. Mrs. Milton Michael, who is secretary, or treasurer, I'm sorry. And Mrs. John Rowell, who is secretary. And Mr. Thomas Bigley, Jr., who is the appointed attorney for the board. And of course, we must have that one person that puts all these people together and all these molds, all these energies, and coordinates all the activities, and takes an able leader and a good administrator. And we here in Bartholomew County feel that we have just that in our library director, Stephen Succo. Steve, would you take a bow? We had extended an invitation to the Honorable Edgar D. Whitcomb, Governor of the State of Indiana. He was unable to be with us today, but he sent to us a representative in Mr. W. Calvert Brand, who is a past state representative and has been a right-hand man of Governor Whitcomb. I will now call on Mr. Brand to give us greetings from the governor. Mr. Brand.
Thank you, John. And I'm sure that the governor would have been very happy to have been here today. Unfortunately, this particular time of the year is an unusually busy time. There are things going on in Indianapolis and all over the state. It's very difficult for the governor to divide himself up into enough pieces. And it's a little more complicated this year because of the NATO meeting, the plans and so forth are necessary for it. It is a real pleasure for me to have the privilege of representing Governor Whitcomb at this dedication of this fine community facility. And I'm sure that those of you who know that I kind of grew up in this committee and this community, I'm sorry, and can remember the area here before some of these wonderful changes did take place. Now, we've had some of the fine facilities for many years here, but certainly some wonderful changes have taken place in recent years. The governor is very proud of Columbus. If you could be with me a number of times and hear him refer to Columbus and Bartholomew County as examples of good government, good industry involvement, good civic pride, and good community effort, you would realize that he really would have enjoyed being with you here today. He has also demonstrated his high regard for this community by the number of appointments that he has made in selecting people from this community to important positions on boards and agencies at the state level. The latest one may not have even become news yet, in that last week he selected Dick Fleming of R.L. Fleming and Associates to be a member of our state personnel board. And that has always been an important board, but it's going to be even more important in the future because of legislation that was enacted in the last session of the General Assembly, changing the procedure for personnel in our state parks, our state Department of Labor, and our state highway system. The state personnel board will be much more involved in all of those areas, in addition to the fact that they will have a major input in implementing the 60-40 bipartisan personnel program that will be going into effect in state government in the future. He also enjoyed his visit here to this fine library late last summer when the budget committee met here, and the community had an opportunity to lobby him a little bit for such things as our comprehensive community mental health center, which as you all know is under construction now. And he is also very much aware of the fine project that resulted in this fine sculpture of the large arch by Henry Moore. In fact, I walked into his office one morning during the legislature to see him about some bills that we were going to need to be considering, and he said, "I was just getting ready to call you," and handed me a note. He said, "I want you to get in touch with the highway department and arrange for them to do anything that's necessary to get the large arch from the Ohio River up to Columbus." He didn't say, "See if they can do it." He said, "Arrange to do anything that's necessary." And even though it wasn't an easy project to plan, I understand the advanced planning was so well done that it was really very simple to get it up here. It came up here in a rather expeditious time. So again, I say that while the governor, I'm sure, would have liked very much to have been here, I consider it a special privilege for me to be here and bring to this fine community, my very favorite community certainly, his very best wishes and continued confidence that Columbus will continue to lead the way in good and better things in the future.
Thank you, Calvert. Project of this type, of course, requires the cooperation of many, many people. But especially, we need the cooperation of the city government in order to make it successful. And let me say to you that we are most thankful for the city government that we had to operate under, because every time we had a request that was within reason, it was met immediately. And we were never held up during construction for lack of cooperation through our city officials. And for this, we thank the city very much. And it gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce to you now the mayor of our city of Columbus, the Honorable Eret Kline. Mayor Kline.
Thank you, John. Mr. Pei, Mr. Weinhardt, distinguished platform guests, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate very much being asked to make a few remarks today because I consider this occasion to be one of the most important during the time I have served as mayor of Columbus. The physical structures on this site say a lot about our community and its spirit, and I would like to briefly express my personal feelings about them and Columbus. I must honestly say that I stand in awe of the genius and the unique spirit represented here today. Those of us in public life are constantly reminded that our town, Columbus, is envied throughout the land, not only for its great buildings, but also for the unusual environment which has made these buildings possible. The structures we see here today represent in many ways those aspects of the community strength upon which we confidently build a bright future. In Mr. Pei's magnificent library, we see an expression of the desire for wisdom and learning. In Mr. Moore's monumental arch, we have tangible evidence of the concern for beauty, high cultural standards, and the creative and progressive urge so evident in our community. In Eliel Saarinen's church, we have a witness to the importance of faith woven into the fabric of our lives. But even more important than the influence of these structures on all our lives is the spirit and effort of the citizens of Columbus and Bartholomew County, which made these wonderful structures possible. People have made the difference in Columbus, and many of those people are here today. There is truly something special about Columbus, something special that brings out the best in all of us. How easy it would be in the face of many problems today to turn away and ignore the challenges and opportunities presented in our society. Yet, people of means and talent in our community from all walks of life choose instead to intensify their efforts to make Columbus better. Not just for us, but better for those who will live in the surroundings we leave for them. This is why the library and the large arch, joining with the church in this place, have so much significance for me and our community. This is why this dedication of physical structures must carry with it a pledge by all of us that we will make the effort to live up to the high standards of spirit and commitment represented tangibly here today. It is because of this creative concern for a full and rich life for all of our citizens that I find serving as mayor of Columbus such a rewarding yet a humbling experience. And I believe I express the sentiments of all citizens of our community when I say a most sincere thank you to all who have made today and all it represents possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Kline. There have been many people who have helped make this all possible, giving freely of their time, talents, and their money. One of these people who cannot be with us today here physically, but certainly spiritually, is Miss Cleo Rogers, after whom our new library building was named. Miss Rogers served as our librarian from 1936 until the time of her death in 1964. But she has left her mark in this community that will long be remembered. The success of a complex project of this magnitude is largely dependent upon those who conceive ideas, plan, and then see that the plan is carried out. We feel that we had the finest of professional help in this respect, and I'm referring now to our architect and all those who helped him. Mr. I.M. Pei, who heads the firm of I.M. Pei and Partners, Architects, is here with us today to make some remarks on this happy occasion. Mr. Pei was born in Canton, China, and came to the United States in 1935 to enter the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, from which he received his Bachelor of Architecture degree in 1940. He received his master's degree in 1946 from the Harvard School of Design. He has been the recipient of many awards for outstanding achievements in architectural design. Most noteworthy of these awards was the Arnold Brunner Award by the National Institute of Arts and Letters for excellence in the field of architecture. Mr. Pei has been active in a number of national organizations, such as American Institute of Architects, American Academy of Arts and Sciences, National Institute of Arts and Letters, and the National Academy of Design. He was appointed to serve on the National Council of Humanities in 1966 by President Lyndon B. Johnson, and has served as a member of the Mayor's Task Force in Urban Design in New York City. Some of the other projects of Mr. Pei and his firm are the John F. Kennedy Library, Dallas City Hall, Dallas, Texas, National Airlines Terminal at John F. Kennedy Airport, International Airport, New York City, the IBM office building in Midtown Manhattan, the East Building of the National Gallery of Art, Washington, D.C., the East-West Center of the University of Hawaii, and many others. Mr. Pei, we are proud of our building and our arch, and we're just very pleased to have you with us here today. It's a great pleasure for me to present to you Mr. I.M. Pei. Mr. Pei.
Distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen. To many of us coming from out of town, and I count myself certainly as one, the emphasis on excellence is almost a password to describe Columbus. But what gives me personally this very great satisfaction today to come here is in something else even more important than that word excellence. And that is the great civic cooperation that makes truly important projects such as this possible. I think probably this is now our sixth year of involvement in Columbus. And looking back, I can think of three major events which prove this point. Number one, I think I have to say that the great foresight of your town fathers in its representatives, the library board, has chosen this very important site to build this building. That's a move of great imagination and great foresight. Secondly, through the cooperation, or rather the active assistance of your city planning group and other elected officials, you are, once again, the community has demonstrated its foresight by approving the closing of Lafayette Street. It's a history now, but it's awfully important when you think in what you have today. And the third, last but not the least, is the foresight of civic leadership, in this case represented by Mr. and Mrs. Miller, to commission this large arch. So here I am today, very proud, very happy to dedicate the library and also to dedicate the large arch. But more important than both of these is to be here to dedicate this open space, this public space, which now is yours. Ieoh Saarinen's church, our building here, Moore's Arch, Irving House, each is made, more important by the presence of this open space. And yet, this open space is more than the sum of all these. So I'm here today to dedicate that idea. And that idea is in turn a dedication to the spirit of the people of Columbus, which your mayor has referred to earlier. I'm very pleased and proud to be here today. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pei. We feel extremely honored, too, this afternoon to be able to have on our program Mr. Carl J. Weinhardt, Jr., director of the Indianapolis Museum of Art. He was born in Indianapolis but spent many of his early days in Boston. He headed for college at the age of 16 and graduated from Harvard University with a Phi Beta Kappa key, magna cum laude honors, and a degree in economics. He returned to Harvard to pursue a degree in education and receive his master's degree. Instead of teaching, however, he spent 3 years working in real estate and historical architecture on Beacon Hill in Boston. Mr. Weinhardt then returned to school a third time to study architecture and art history. In this, he found a field he wanted to make his profession. He then accepted a position with the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. He left the Met to become the director of the Minneapolis Institute of Art, being the youngest director of the top 10 American museums. After 3 years of reorganizing and expanding in Minneapolis, he returned to New York as director of the Gallery of Modern Art. In 1965, Mr. Weinhardt came back to Indiana as director of the Indianapolis Museum of Art and has guided it through its recent building program. He is regarded as one of the top museum directors in the country. And it is a great pleasure for me to present to you Mr. Carl J. Weinhardt, Jr. Mr. Weinhardt.
Thank you for your very kind words. Mr. Pei, Mayor Kline, President Keach, Dr. Hoven, Reverend Brandt, Mr. and Mrs. Miller, honored guests, and ladies and gentlemen. America, America, God shed his grace on thee with Burger Kings and Dairy Queens from sea to shining sea. This is the way that one of our most sensitive and deeply concerned architectural critics recently defined the current and alarming direction in which our country seems to be heading today. If this is indeed the current in which we are being swept along, and I'm afraid there are few that can deny that this is true, Then I would like to title my remarks, Boats Against the Current. It is a rare privilege and honor for me to be here today and to be a part of what must be, for each of you in your own way and for all of you together, a most meaningful and pride-filled civic event. For you are met in an act of affirmation, a dedication by living creators to life. You are here to affirm your faith in the permanence that is embodied in the storehouse for knowledge and learning, a structure which remains at the vital center of community sharing, its library. The town library is a depository of the best of our accumulated knowledge, represents both the common brain and heart of the community. And to it now is added a monument, an archway, which adds to a cultural heritage that is already deep and rich, and extends an invitation to all who pass by. An arch is inevitably the symbol of a door, a gate, a portal, an entrance into something new. One of the arch gates to the Harvard Yard in Cambridge, Massachusetts, bears the words, "Enter to grow in wisdom," cut in stone in small letters above the entrance. And on the other side, so that you see it when you leave, "Depart to serve thy country better." Our large arch here does not need to use words to express its meaning, which is perhaps less specific, but more general and much more profound. This is a special occasion for each of you here, for you individually, for your town, for our state, and in a larger sense, for our country and even our world. It is at the same time a peculiarly special occasion for me personally, and I would like briefly to try to share the reasons for this with you. About 100 years ago, my great-grandfather, Dr. John Philip Rosegan, who had been a surgeon in the Union Army during the Civil War, came to settle here in Columbus and eventually built his house, which still stands on the southeast corner of 8th and Lafayette, or Mechanic Street, as it used to be called then. During most of my childhood, my family made an almost weekly pilgrimage to that house from Indianapolis for Sunday dinner. And after a large meal, if I had behaved well enough, I was allowed to walk the several blocks down to Irwin's Gardens. And in a very real way, this corner where we stand now became a turning point for me very early in life. And this turn started me down a long path, which happily has led me back to this same, but now very different corner today. For these gardens provided my first awareness of the romance and beauty of the old world of our Western European heritage. The spatial experience of those gardens and even some of what seemed the exotic colors and scents of the flowers are still vivid in my memory. The whole became so etched in my mind that I still at this moment could draw a fairly accurate ground plan of its beauties, although I must admit it no longer seems quite as gigantic as it did in the eyes of a 10-year-old. Then suddenly a new and dramatic dimension was added to the scene when I was about 14 in the form of the First Christian Church across the street. For the first time, I was stunned by the beauty of the great architecture of our own time, which replaced a small flat park with its diagonal paths. It provided not only an interruption to my most direct route to the ice cream parlor, but a highly important experience in my life, which once and for all fixed my continuing interest in architecture and art. So in a real sense, I can join with you in this living dedication to express our belief in some lasting and time-proven symbols that sustain and enrich our existence, and to honor those who have offered us the very finest of their human efforts. For in the final analysis, it is a translation of those ideals and symbols which mankind hold dear into bricks and mortar and bronze by man that is the higher purpose which we honor today. Would we be half so proud of this achievement had man played no role in its creation? I think not.
Man-made and handmade are, thank God, still awesome concepts. In a time when ideals are clearly becoming more precious each day and ever harder to hold on to, and the impersonal public space has become the rule of thumb, we can rejoice that a personal sense of beauty can be shared by us all and yet remain intimate and human in concept and scale and the resulting pleasure that it gives to each of us and to all of us. It is true that on one hand, there are many precedents in form and content for what we see before us. The threads of history which make up the fabric of civilization vary in texture and hue in the dimensions of space and time. Yet it is the unconscious but knowing references and cross-references which enrich and keep vital the whole cloth that forms the backdrop against which we judge our lives. On the other hand, the great monuments of the past have always been marked by the unique and personal hand of genius, which, while actively conversant with its own time, battles against the contemporary current forces of lesser vision. The exception makes the rule may be an old grammatical cliche, but isn't this, after all, how we define masterpiece on the rare and happy occasions when one confronts us? We should look at each part of the total achievement which we are honoring today with these thoughts in mind, for they form the basis of our final judgment of the degree of the success of each of the parts and ultimately the whole. The Cleo Rogers Memorial Library by A.M. Pei remains the ennobling qualities of the great libraries of history, while at the same time relating directly to the domestic scale of its site in both material and plan. The brick recalls earlier surrounding structures, and there is a serene, quiet, welcoming, and sheltering quality about the building as an entity. The variety and multiplicity of approaches from grand vistas to narrow passages surprise and delight the senses. It is so thoroughly cultural in concept that one cannot help recalling another library in another extraordinary city, the Laurentian Library by Michelangelo in Florence, Italy. Like Columbus, Florence was relatively small in terms of the numbers of its citizens, but incredibly rich in the number of its great monuments. The large arch, which stands in front of this building, is without question the most important piece of sculpture now in Indiana. And it is appropriate that it should be located in the city that boasts the most impressive concentration of superb contemporary architecture in the Midwest and one of the greatest in the nation. Henry Moore is certainly the greatest living sculptor. And from our vantage point, three quarters of the way through this century, he seems to be the uncontested giant of the 20th century. The quarter of a century that remains to us will have to produce an unrivaled titan to surpass him. In his own lifetime, he has become one of the old masters of modern art. His Columbus arch, set as it is in this native version of a Roman piazza, provides a gateway to the diversity of the surrounding architecture and spaces. An invitation to investigate and enjoy in this small plaza nearly a century of our architectural heritage. From the Irwin House and Gardens by Wendell Phillips, with its roots in Italian villas and their Hudson River descendants, and with a dash of the influence of early Frank Lloyd Wright, to Eliel Saarinen's First Christian Church, which is clearly linked to the Bauhaus precedents and the international style, and yet also looks to medieval Italy and its 166-foot campanile, and finally to the library. In it, Mr. Pei reminds us once again, as he did in the magnificent new Boston Government Center, that the term architecture means not only the spaces enclosed by a structure, but just as importantly, the spaces it leads us around, and by extension, the spaces it excludes. Here we have a clear, resounding statement of what that exclusion can become at its best, a public space that brings together its strongly individuated parts through the empathy evident between those parts. It is in this connection that I believe we can see what the very significant contribution of art, architecture, and philanthropy can mean to the city of the 20th century. Historically, there are very few great cities in the world which have fully realized and captured the fundamental importance of the open space in relation to art and architecture, and managed to hang on to it. Rome is perhaps the greatest of those and can really only be defined in terms of its grandly haphazard successions of piazzas with their rich interplay of fountains, sculpture, and architecture. Paris, of course, has its great tree-lined boulevards and its elaborately calculated and sometimes overly grandiose plazas, which dominate rather than enlarge the individual. And lastly, Boston alone, for the most part in this country, has retained any true living sense of the importance of the open public space. Its common, as the name implies, is even more important and more integral to the life of that city than New York's Central Park is to New York. In thinking over recent attempts in American cities to open up public spaces, it is difficult to find any that one could call completely successful in the aesthetic sense, apart from the government center in Boston, and the hue and cry from the populace reflects this failure, which is more often than not the result of externally imposed limitations in concept and approach. Chicago's famed Picasso is still the subject of such furious outcries that it's called a scandal almost as often as it is called a triumph. The plaza in front of the Seagram Building in New York was referred to as wasteful when it was announced, and it is a questionable success at best in terms of being a living space for people. This is through no failure of the magnificent tower it enhances, but due to the surrounding unrelated structures which give it some of the unwanted and inappropriate qualities of a wind tunnel and turn its fountains into unpredictable shower baths. It is not, however, the critics' disapproval that adjudges these public spaces as failures, but rather that the public has experienced the inadequacies of them and has responded accordingly. We have never really come to terms in this country with the fact that man must somehow cohabit our urban areas with the internal combustion engine, and that we must give man more than some faraway nondescript park as his only escape from the congested street or the merchant's window. Our major cities are strangling on what might be called history's biggest case of acid indigestion. Unfortunately, a large Tums tablet, such as the pop sculptor Klaus Oldenburg might produce, will not solve the problem. The water, air, and noise pollution represent only a part of the dilemma. To some extent, these can be resolved, and many reasonably successful efforts are being made in this direction. While this may help to heal man's physical ailments, it fails to reach his spiritual maladies, and the burgeoning visual pollution around us is an even greater threat to our healthy mental existence in this world. It is man's spirit, his sense of community, that is nurtured by a splendid nearby outdoor living room such as this. For here, once again, he is king. And here he can begin to relate, as once he did long ago, in a positive, meaningful, and active way to his immediate environment. But in order to interact with man, these spaces must have a vital interplay among their component parts, rather than be a static, unimaginative combination of disparate elements. Happily, this is true in the case we have before us today. Here each of the elements, the house, the church, the library, and the arch, which unites them visually and symbolically, could stand alone as a work of art. But here each is strengthened and reinforced in impact by its relationship to its neighbors, or more properly, its family. After one has visited many of the large metropolises of our nation and then turns to Columbus, he cannot but be struck, and likely even awestruck, with the brilliance of what surrounds him here. I should imagine it would be very difficult for anyone to explain the blight which threatens the majority of our urban areas to the citizens of Columbus if they had not seen it for themselves elsewhere. Few cities have had the great good fortune to be blessed with such resources and vision detached from personal reward. Athens had it, of course, and Florence under the Medicis, and then London was blessed with a fire. But to provide for a small city in the agrarian heart of our country the exposure to those things which only the very well-traveled have really experienced elsewhere, and then only in passing, is to have a sense of community, of responsibility, which is, even in our century, almost unique in Western history. We'd like to ask you to join me in a tribute to patrons with a vision, a sense of dedication and purpose, whose generosity and wise counsel is yet on the ascendancy, Mr. and Mrs. J. Irwin Miller. To an inspired creator of architecture, Mr. Pei, who is also with us today. And to a great sculptor, Henry Moore, who could not join us this afternoon, but whose spirit will, from today on, be vibrantly pleasant in this will be vibrantly present in this plaza in the form of the large arch. May we have a moment's applause for the creators. This, then, is a celebration, a thanksgiving, not only to these creators whom we here honor, but in a much broader sense to a tradition which reaches back in our history more than 2,500 years. So we move on into the future, but guided by and enriched with the best lessons and examples of the past. I'm reminded of the closing lines from what is, to my mind, perhaps the finest American novel, The Great Gatsby. They go as follows. Gatsby believed in the green light, the orgiastic future that year by year recedes before us. It eluded us then, but that's no matter. Tomorrow will run faster. Stretch out our arms farther, and one fine morning. So we beat on, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past. We honor here the dedication of three such boats against the current. Men who by their wisdom and talents have enriched our lives immeasurably and who have created a past for us and for future generations of citizens. For all these works, including the new library and the arch, are now already history, a part of our ongoing tradition, which is now immeasurably enriched through their existence. In closing, I will take the liberty of paraphrasing a sentence in what is our greatest national historical address of dedication, and say, the world will little note what we say here today, but it will long remember what we see here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Weinhardt. I know that you're extremely busy at this time of the year, and we appreciate it very much that you took time out of your busy schedule to come down here and make this dedication address. We appreciate it very much. We'll now have a number from the Columbus High School Choir. And as the number is, "And We Shall Live as Brothers."
Shall live as brothers. All people in the world shall live.
Thank you, Mr. Robertson, and your group for that delightful music. I want to take this opportunity to thank the Hauser Band, too, for coming down and being with us this afternoon. Before we have the benediction, I do have two announcements I would like to make. First of all, there will be a reception immediately following our dedication ceremony here in the lower terrace that's just outside the children's library, and the easiest way to get to it is down this entrance over on the west side of the library through the children's area and out onto the terrace. And all of you are invited. We'd be glad to have you. Refreshments will be served. Secondly, beginning at 4 o'clock, we will show some film strips in the Red Room, which is also in the lower level of the library, on Mr. Pei and on Mr. Henry Moore, and those will run continuously as long as you would like to stay and see them. I will now ask the Reverend Eldon L. Brandt, pastor of St. Peter's Lutheran Church, to give us the benediction. Reverend Brandt.
Now may the blessing of the Almighty and ever-living God rest upon you so that you may use this library and arch for God's glory and the edification of people, so that it may be a constant reminder of the greatness and goodness of God, of the love of Jesus Christ, the gateway to life, and may the Holy Spirit guide and lead us so that we may employ these to his glory and for the edification of people today and for decades to come. Amen.
This concludes our program. Thank you very much for coming.